I'm looking to develop a complete and effective TOC decision support process, which is actually focused on the most basic decisions that managers, or executive actually, those who really run the company, need to make. Because what is more basic than what should we sell? I think, what kind? Pipes for petrol or other pipes? And how much? And what price? And what variety? All those, these are actually the very basic of the company strategy. And I think the need for it came quite a lot because the late Eli Goldratt started to put up the strategy and went so much with developing strategy and developing the tools for it. And for me, this is a kind of a missing element. And there is a little bit of surprise in it because I think that many people in the TOC world think that there is already, there is throughput accounting, there is an answer. However, Eli Goldratt himself understood that he does not have an answer. And here I want to tell you the story, I mean, which I've seen in it, because I have started to think about it relative something like 98, 99, when I was invited by a company that was developing activity-based costing software, and they want to have a TOC model in it. So I started to think and work with them. Eventually, I mean, they came up with a prototype, but then they went into financial difficulties and they were sold, so the whole idea was stopped there. But I already kept thinking about it, and then I had the honor to be invited by Eli Goldratt to participate in necessary and but not sufficient. So I was in room with Eli, Carol Petak, and thinking about the book, and Eli started to say something like this. Look, he told us, TOC currently has three main engines, DBR, replenishment, and CCPM for project. And then I asked, what about throughput accounting? And then Eli told me something like this. He said, look, Eli said, I have a problem with throughput accounting because people expect me to give them a number and I cannot give them a number. Eli, many times, I mean, I knew him from many years, had this kind of thing to be, you know, like an oracle. He tells you something without full explanation. How it tied in, where it comes from, where it goes. I think I understand him correctly. And several years later, when already there was a beginning of the S&T tool, I asked him again, why should we not develop the full power of throughput accounting? And again, he told me, said, Eli, you are absolutely right. It needs to be developed. Only not now. Because his mind was still on some of the aspect of the overall strategy. So here I am now, 2.5, almost 3 years after Eli is gone, at least looking at it, trying to look on throughput accounting and also giving you some warning a little bit about it. But let us go with it. How decisions, generally speaking, decision about new opportunities are made today. Okay? If you got some kind of idea of entering China, a new opportunity, generally speaking, what is the process of checking it and eventually coming to some? So one possibility that I think is pretty wide with top-level executives, eventually it all comes into intuition. In some cases, I don't think it's all over the board. I think only in some cases people are still looking for cost per unit because it gives them confidence that this is written in the book, so they cannot be blamed. But I think the vast majority have already the feeling that this is not the answer. TOC people, at least those who were raised on TOC, would like to deal with it with T by constraint unit, and I already tell you I'm going to attack it pretty hard. The last thing is again doing some kind of very detailed calculations, both the financial and the capacity aspect, that people will do somehow. They'll say we need this and we need this, and let us try to come up with numbers, and it's not a very robust process, but at least it looks into it. But then of course this takes quite a lot of time and a lot of belief that what you do is about right. Because we cannot run totally away from capacity aspects. We need somehow to include it. Now, I ask myself, and fellows, feel free to intervene, to see if to come up with those kind of decisions with the current tools, it's not easy. So you need to add intuition, and fellow, intuition is quite frightening. If this is the main thing that I'm relying on it, it's quite frightening. And if I need to make very detailed research, something like this, this in itself takes quite a lot of months and quite a lot of money going into it. And then I'm not sure how much I can fully rely on it. Then what is the outcome? Well, for me, and I think I looked on quite a lot of organizations that I had the chance to look something into them, that quite a lot of real market opportunities are not even checked. They are ruled out because somehow they look risky, somehow I'm not sure about it, and this is all. And fellow Moses, than anything else, what I've seen in the vast majority of the companies, there is some kind of, I think Goddard would call it stagnation. Which means this is a market we have, this is a market we know, we don't really consider and we don't really try anything else. We try to keep what we already have. And this I think is the majority of the organizations that I know, certainly medium level, small and medium level, are like this. I think also the big ones are also quite a lot on known territories. Now, let us understand what I mean by opportunity, and I took a very small kind of example. Suppose you are a manufacturing company and a potential client gives you an offer. It's potential client. Currently, he's not your client, but you like him to be your client. I say, all right, let me try first a monthly delivery of several products. Only, I'm not going to pay you the price you ask for everybody, i.e. 15% less. Let us say that from, you know, small numbers immediately that someone can put on paper. Let us assume that the monthly total quantity would add 13% to the total revenues. But they will take more capacity because you see, because of this kind of reduction in price, the capacity you need for all the quantity, but what you get from it is a little bit less. So the impact on the revenues is less, relatively, than the impact on capacity. Now, let us suppose you already know that what you have is five critical work centers. And you get something like that machine one, it's a very critical one, and to process everything additional, it will need another 7% of its current capacity. And then M2 need 21%, M3 needs 11, M4 needs 18, M5 needs 6. On average, it's 15. On average. They are different in impact. Also, you are aware that currently M3 is your weakest link. And it is already loaded with the current market. They use the full price. It's loaded to 93% of its available capacity. And for me, fellows, this is the question. Not the question, should you take it or not take it? My question for you, for everyone, for every executive, what do you need to know to get information in order to make a decision whether this is a very good opportunity or this is shy away? You cannot live with such kind of price reduction. Well, suppose you are, what information do you need?
You need to have some information about if you have, from my point of view, you have to increase your capacity of your weakest link there. And perhaps other work centers too. So what additional investment would you need?
To increase capacity. Okay.
As information.
Or what is the other opportunity that there is? If not increasing capacity, maybe I can reduce demand somehow of something else. I will look to my least profitable product and say I'm stopping to produce it. Okay.
What I have to abandon, in
fact. Yes, what you might need to abandon or what you might need to add. Well, this is very good what you told me. Please see how many executives will come to this answer very clearly. That these are the information that they need. Sort of. I will go to it. First, when I look on the history of TOC, because this is now also a little bit my topic, what can we learn from the history of TOC, the history of development? And back in 1983, Goddard became very famous, or infamous, when he really declared in Epics, cost accounting is enemy number one of productivity. And this made him famous.
It was in 83.
It's written correctly, but back in 1983. I was not there. I came only in 85. Okay. So you witness it. Okay. So this created huge amount of reaction, mostly negative, but this was also positive because, you know, people started to argue and suddenly things were... So it created huge resistance because at that time, but I claim it still is, product costing is the most common way to make decisions, especially in manufacturing. Would you agree?
No, unfortunately.
Fellows, for me, when I joined Goldratt, I remember one thing. When I started about 10 years before that, I started my MBA studies, and I had this professor for accounting who told the students that every manager who is using cost per unit as is an idiot who eventually will get what he deserves. Long before Goldratt. As a student, we immediately asked, I think the obvious question, if this is the case, how do you make those kind of decisions? And here I think what he made the wrong answer, because he said every case should be analyzed based on its own merit. And the thing about this is executives cannot afford to do this, because executive fellows are under direct fear. If I will make a decision, and this is me making this decision, if from whatever reason, eventually there will be some negative results, I will get the whole blame. If what I did was based on a book, what can you tell me? I went through the book. Okay. I tried to look on cost accounting, including activity-based costing. And I came to a certain verbalization that there is a hidden assumption there. And the hidden assumption is it is possible, at least in the long time period, to match capacity to demand. Look, I was, to come up with this, I based it on the book by Robert Kaplan. Professor Kaplan was the one who developed activity-based costing, professor from Harvard. Back in the 80s, Eli Goldratt and him had quite a lot of public debate. And in cost and effect, it's very interesting, fellow. I think I mentioned it, but anyway, I will mention it now, because he said something very clearly. He said, in the short term, TOC gives the right answer. If you are constrained by a certain resource, go to TOC, it will give you. In the longer term, it's up to you how much capacity you have. And here, if you want to make it, you need activity-based costing. But then what it means is exactly this, that Robert Kaplan, and I assume many other people, somehow back in their mind there is this kind that it is somehow possible to match capacity to demand throughout the organization. And so activity-based costing gives you also the cost of idle capacity. It was not before that. So they understand, okay, there is idle capacity, but this is what it costs to you, and for you as a manager, this is your challenge. You need to face it, and you need to reduce it, maybe even to eliminate it. So it does not claim, Robert Kaplan, that this is easy to do. Just say it's possible to do somehow. Hello, I think this is totally invalid assumption in our reality. And actually, there are three different causes that will make it invalid. That even in the future, with all my planning abilities, and suppose I have enough money, etc., I will not be able to match capacity to demand. And I need to know it a priori. One is, I try to get from TOC, I think one of the most meaningful thing, at least from DBR, that in order to have predictable performance, most resources must have excess capacity, excess protected capacity. Because when demand fluctuates and when the capacity itself fluctuating. Maybe one resource you can get the vast majority of the capacity really turned into value, but in order to make this one very high utilization, you need all the others to have spare. Okay, realization of TOC. Fellows, there is another very big reason. Purchasing capacity is possible only in certain sizes. Allow me, because we talk here, to give you some kind of a lesson I learned when I studied to my undergraduate degree. I studied physics. So there was a story that caught my attention because it was kind of dramatic story in physics, dramatic story. And it was in 1870 about, the physics, the people, professor of that time assumed that whatever concerned optics, they know everything. They have already the equation of light going through and electromagnetic waves going through. So there are all the equations are there. There is nothing else that we can do in optics. And then someone published a paper about radiation from a black box. And he made the simple mathematical integral of going through all the frequencies, and it went to infinity. The integral went to infinity. Now, practically it would mean that the black box would be blast. I mean, we cannot have anything. Now, physics are effect cause effect people. What they got was something very embarrassing. It looks like something is wrong in the theory, because there was no mathematical fault in what this one did. And so they called it the catastrophe in the ultraviolet. They gave it a name. See the dramatics of the name, the catastrophe in the ultraviolet. Why in the ultraviolet? Because this was the trouble was, the higher frequencies. And so it contained more energy. So, fellows, the solution. There were all kinds of explanations until then, but the solution came only in the beginning of the 20th century, which means about 40 years later, in the shape of quantum theory, when it was understood frequencies are not continuous. They jump according to Planck constants or something of the sort. I don't remember the details. And when you took these equations into that integral, everything solved. And what I got from it that comes all the way back to capacity was the mathematics of continuous function and the mathematics of discrete numbers are totally different. And so you need to watch. And let me tell you, I've seen quite a lot of academic paper about cost functions, and they assume that they are continuous function. More they assume that they can be derivable infinite times, and they got into all fellows. Cost also, like capacity, is discrete numbers. Okay? We have even our money as a minimum. And then this is not the case when you buy things. You cannot buy them in whole numbers. When you purchase capacity, can you purchase from, let us say, even of one of your employees? Can I purchase from you 32 minutes and 44 seconds of your time? This is not done, right? Many times I will say, okay, the minimum is another hour. You want overtime? Okay. 1 hour is the minimum. Okay, good. Certain sizes that you can buy. Some of the quantums are very large. Like if I have a certain machine and I need to add capacity to the machine, maybe I have a machine with half capacity, but that's it, I mean. My freedom, my flexibility is very limited here, right? So, fellow, how it comes? It means that whatever plan of capacity I need to do, I need to take into account what is the sizes of additional capacity are, and if you tell me that I need 21% more, could be the answer either 0 or 100. Make a decision. Okay? I cannot give you 21%. Nothing like this. Sometimes, not always. And there is a third one. This kind of real observation on the world. Market demand changes faster than the ability to change the capacity levels. Okay? Because of this, again, what does it mean? That whatever planned capacity I should based on my peak demand and tolerate the off-peak demand, that I have excess capacity, which is most of the time. Okay, fellows, I didn't know. I assume everybody here knows what is throughput, right? So please, let me just, if this is the case, just jump with it, because I included it here. Okay, I assume everybody is living very good with this. Delta profit is actually delta T minus delta OE, and when whatever decision I contemplate, I expect it to be this to be positive, right? It's negative. What's happening here? Why do you create yourself a loss?
Generally, in cost accounting, we don't include the stock, in fact. I think that's also a point, which is a problem in cost accounting. Because with cost accounting, you measure your output, your operating element, you divide that, but the cost of stock, if you need to increase your stock, is not taken into account.
Yes, because they don't really relate to the uncertainty and how to deal with uncertainty. Because eventually stock is your protection level against uncertainty. And funny that I'm saying it, but I haven't seen in, I'm not aware that in accounting they really gave a lot of thinking about dealing with uncertainty. The only thing I hear a little bit is about financial reserves, some reserves that are done in accounting, and the numbers that I have seen are so ridiculously low that I think they still don't look on reality, because the reality is much more demanding than this. But even with your question, please see. Also TOC we don't too much take into account the cost of stock, and the whole notion what is the cost of stock, we can debate about it. In normal accounting, I mean, not for decision making, but they are taking added value on stock, normally. These are related usually also to the tax laws. Okay, so you need to, Eli Goldratt claimed that we should not add any cost to the really cost of purchasing. It's not 100% true, but it's close enough, which means I can find some cases in which I need to think about the cost of stock, and certainly in distribution, I think we need, especially in distribution systems. Because in distribution system, really the vast majority of the cash of the company is invested in stock. Normally in manufacturing, this is not the case. Of course, there is investment in stock, but it's not, 80% of your investment. But if you take a large distribution company, oh yes, this is the vast majority is in stock, and then how do you relate to the what are the holding cost of inventory and things like this, and it's not a trivial question at all. I intend to deal with it, but again, not right now. I think I need some things to do. But eventually, certainly for distribution, there should be more tools that will take. And Eli spoke about inventory dollar days, and I'm not certain that this is the best answer. It's a partial answer. It gives something, but not enough. The basics of the TOC decision support. I think the division between delta T and delta OE is a great insight, even though it's a simple but great. Why? Because the parameters that impact delta T are very different than the parameters that are impacting delta OE. And so it makes the calculation easier, because if you did not care to make this kind of separation between the truly variable cost that goes into the throughput and the cost that it's never fixed cost, okay, but the other cost that do not change very fast with the demand that goes into delta OE, then the dependencies between them are overwhelming and they cannot do it very easily. Once we know to separate them, then actually, I'm not saying it's easy, because it's still not easy, but much less complicated than if I just look like revenues minus expenses. Small difference between the two, but practically it's very different. Now, when a capacity constraint is active, then T is lost due to the capacity limitation of the CCR. Fellow, this is my understanding of what does it mean, a capacity constraint. It means I could sell more, but I cannot make more because I have this bastard that can do only this amount and not more. From this came the idea of throughput per constraint unit, because if this one resource really limits your ability to sell, then every minute of it counts. So how much throughput can you do per minute depending on what you sell and how much price the market is ready to give to you? So this is T by constraint unit. So it is used to measure the effectiveness of the product mix and whatever, and whether it could be improved. If I sell more of this, will I get more? If this gives me, product A gives me more than product B, T per constraint unit, I should try to sell as many A's, even if I need to reduce the number of B's. One of the things that I find out in the accounting, They know about marginal costing, and marginal costing is very similar to TUC. Marginal costing have a lot of resistance, and from some good reason, so I try to put a little bit why they are not the same. Because I believe that quite a lot of the claims against marginal costing have been solved by contract. So it is a costing methodology that actually look for the net contribution, which is exactly throughput, the different name, to base a short-term decision. Let us ignore the small differences between contribution and throughput. There are clear differences. First of all, marginal costing, cost accounting in general, don't really look for capacity profiles. Fellow, they look on capacity as if it is a cost driver, which means every time you invest capacity, you need to pay for it. This is a basic notion of it, right? And it does not look on limitations. You see, because of this kind of assumption that you should be able to match capacity to demand. And so if you have more demand, okay, get more capacity as much as you need for the cost, etc., etc. So they don't look for the capacity profiles, but this is part of the things that TOC have taught us. Look, you are constrained by capacity. This is what you can do. Now the question is, what is the best you can do with under this limitation? This is exactly this thinking that is not, to my mind, does not exist in the norm of marginal costing. And because of this, marginal costing did huge mistakes. And so people have noticed that they went through this and then they got something very bad because eventually it looked like we get more because of this, but somebody did not see how much throughput was lost because of capacity limitation that you have took yourself too much. This one. TOC looks on T as a key measurement with the organization like to maximize. And this is not done even in organizations that naturally looks all the time on throughput. What does most of the distributors do? What they call margin. Most of the time in distribution, margin is exactly by how much we sell minus by how much we paid to the supplier. To my mind, in the vast majority of those, they do not look, you know, for the allocating the transportation cost and the inventory holding cost. Most of the time, they don't do this mathematics. So they look on the real, what they call margin is what we call throughput. It's the same thing, right? No. Because what they don't do is they don't look on the total of all the margins. They still look on every product on its own. They don't look by the question, by setting this scheme, setting this supermarket with this amount of sales going on, what is my total margin versus my total operating expense, which is my regular cost, not my purchasing cost, but my the purchase of the building, of the people working, of the energy, of everything. They don't do this. Even though they look on throughput, basically. So reducing price is very carefully checked because the direct impact on T is very much significant. And this, again, they don't do because they don't look on the total. Because one of the questions that we ask about a promotion, okay, you are making a promotion. Let us assume you will solve 50% more units. When is it a good idea? When it is a bad idea? Because in order to sell 50% more, you gave, let us assume, 10% reduction in price. So it should be, you will get much more revenues, right? 50% more quantity for 10% less price will get you more revenues. What about your throughput? Because think a little bit, if, by the way, it's exists in India, not so much in the Western world, that even in distribution, sometimes the throughput is about 20%. India is kind of a country in which the push on the price for the consumer is huge. So people cannot afford, and people are, consumers are really led to check the prices very carefully. So they try to get away with the very limited throughput. Now think, if throughput is 20% and you gave 10% reduction, you are getting 50% less throughput. Now, 50% of 150% is less than 100%, right? Just to give you this kind of potential impact. Generally speaking, I should say salespeople, you want to measure them? I have a question about why do you want to measure them so much, but if you need to measure them, at least measure them on throughput and not on revenues, because this is by mean huge mistake that forces them to do mistakes. I come now to, with all due respect, throughput accounting has limitations. Because this is a logical claim. Product mix decisions are impacted by the capacity availability of only one critical resource. First of all, do you agree that this is the understanding of most people who learn some TOC? Do you agree?
Try to find the constraint, yes. Yeah, we try to find one constraint. You try to find one,
and then, according to throughput accounting, it leads you, sort of, to do your calculation based on it. Is it really that it is impacted by only one critical constraint? And fellow, I some kind thank Professor Kaplan, because I think he at least voiced one criticism on TOC that is valid. When TOC said this, TOC had short-term look. Assuming there is a constraint, and it's not going to change very soon, and even if you do some decision, this will be the limitation. When you go out of this, we need to think a little bit more. Then it cannot be that all my decisions are impacted by one critical resource. By the way, TOC never said there is only one constraint. It more said that if you have interactive constraints, your performance will not be perfect. This was real understanding. Now, what happens if we contemplate a large decision? We need to consider the options that another resource would become either an interactive constraint or even a bottleneck. You see, if you remember my example from the start, currently M3 is the weakest link. But if we take this order, that did not took all our products, so the change in our product mix is significant. Where is your constraint now? Are you absolutely sure you have only one and it is the same one that you know now? Okay, it's part of the things that we'll need to take into account. Now, in my life in TLC, I've seen huge amount of damage caused by people sticking to the throughput per constraint unit and not understanding the underlying assumption behind it, which in the vast majority of the cases in reality, those assumptions are not valid. So, one basic assumption. There is an active internal constraint and only one. Well, Alan Barnard have shown in one of his that if there are two constraints, T by constraint unit, I mean, he tried to do some kind of average and claims this is good enough, but he already showed that it changes the whole perspective. So it cannot be really addressed as is. I would say more. How many organizations you have seen in which they do have an active internal constraint throughout the year? I've seen such. I've seen, okay, basic steel manufacturing. They have a furnace that needs to work all the time. And whatever you look into it, everything it does eventually can be sold. It can be sold in different products, different level of throughput. But everything needs to be sold. You cannot stop it anyway. You can a little bit accelerate it or deaccelerate it. You have some kind of small flexibility in it, but that's it. And this kind of furnace is something like hundreds of millions of euros. I mean, it's huge. It's not a small oven. Something huge. Okay, this one. What else? What else? When TLC came, that was the beginning of the 80s, generally speaking, there was lack of capacity relative to the demand, which gave quite a lot of manufacturing organization kind of, you know, they are safe because the demand is more than what they can do. Then what TLC showed to them, you think you do what you can do, actually you can do much more if you really understand where your limitations are. Okay, this was already quite a big insight. But for economically in the world, what happened is currently, in the vast majority of the cases, we have much more capacity in the world than demand. Don't know really about petrol pipes. But generally speaking, there's more capacity than needed, which already gives. If you are not constrained inside, what is deeper constraint you need? You just choose your weakest link and you do this on it, and your weakest link maybe is loaded 75% of its time, of its capability. You see, so there is one in which we already see currently. There are cases like this, certainly, but not too many. Then comes the other realization. It took me a long time, I mean, to understand it. The decision under consideration is relatively small and thus would not cause another constraint to emerge. So really think, if TLC at first really looked shorter, this is your situation now. Your flow now is 100 units an hour. Actually, your limitation is 120, if you really look on your constraint. So why don't you look hard into it and do 120 because you have the market for you? Okay. But then please understand, I'm looking on a relatively short time frame and on small, relatively small decision, like I will increase the production of product A by 5%, and I will reduce production B by 2%. And this, based on T by constraint unit, will give me better profit. But if I have a decision that is 15% of my total capacity, on average, again, hello, I'm not sure at all. Thus, in most cases, we cannot or should not use T by constraint unit as a simple tool to determine whether a certain deal, client, or market segment are worth to go after. First, let me tell you when I've seen it and I was bewildered. A great company in projects, doing projects, the projects have two parts. One, design, engineering design, which is long, and then they also produce, but they don't produce, 100 units. They produce one unit, and one unit is in the size of this room about. Okay, so it takes months and things like this. And they made a T by constraint unit based on skilled manpower building this one. Fellows, it does not make sense. First of all, project, you can now understand this certainly not continuous, right? There are bigger projects and smaller projects, but you don't speak about 10,000 projects. You speak maybe, even though it's a very large company, but 100 projects at the same time, this is already a very large company we are speaking, right? And they are of different sizes. And can you think that the sizes count here? How much you can put here, how much you can add a project and just based on it, on the available capacity, and that's it. It's possible. And when they do throughput by constraint unit also on something like manpower, totally wrong. First, what is still valid is delta T minus delta OE. This is valid if we really succeed to calculate delta T and to calculate delta OE in a good enough manner. Okay? Back to basic sort. Of course, we look on the holistic thing. Delta T takes into account that maybe lack of capacity will reduce my regular T, and it's part of delta T. And then delta OE is again, if I increase my overtime, delta OE went up. So we need to calculate or consider all the current throughput generated by the current sales, the current level of operating expenses, and the capacity status of all resources. Well, this is far from POC. Simple, clear focus, right? It looks like, okay, fellow, sorry, you need to consider everything. Well, still, can you see, I speculate that this is what Goldratt had in mind when they say, people expect me to give them a number and I cannot give them a number. Because there are more than one or two simple variables that we need to take into account. So there is a question, can we do it? Because it's slide back. First, I like to update a key TOC paradigm, not going all the way to complexity that is meaningless because I cannot deal with it, but to something maybe that I still can deal with. And I treat a group of critical resources. And I claim that this group cannot be too large. Because come on, in every organization that you know, fellows, how many resources you will call critical? Which means at some point in time, it could become a bottleneck. Probably more than one. I really assume not more than five, but I'm open to discussion. If it is six, okay, six. That's about it. Please understand that all the other resources, we have too much capacity to start with, and this is okay because, again, this is the way we can purchase capacity, and this capacity is not so expensive, so why should we even think too much about it? Let us have enough. So, I don't think that it's valid for an organization to be constrained by the number of mobile phones that they have in the company. Even though, think about it, if there is a limitation on the number of mobile phones, could be that sales are lost. But what's the point, right? Let's give everybody a mobile phone. What's the point? So a critical resource is a resource that might become a capacity constraint if and when the product mix changes in a certain way. And my observation really, and also my understanding about what are the levels of complexity that managers can manage anyway, that it cannot be too many, but could be more than one, definitely could be more than one. We need some good enough data of those few resources to support further assessment of the required capacity for a certain product mix. More than that, I assume we are able to roughly assess in the beginning the required protective capacity of the weakest link and then the protective capacity of the other critical resources. Look, I claim for quite a lot of time that the constraint should not be a bottleneck. Meaning, it's okay that we have an internal capacity constraint. You should not load it to 100% because then there will be, you will cause bad performance to the market, and this is exactly what you cannot afford. Because if the market will go down on you, then your constraint is no longer a constraint because there is not so much demand. Do you see my point here, right? So you should not load any resource to truly 100%. First, actually Goldratt said it, but in a different ways. Somehow, when he explained his the verbalization of the second step in the five focusing step, decide how to exploit the capacity constraint. Fellow, first of all, it's very strange. The second step is not exploit your constraint, but decide how, which Goldratt explained. There are some judgment needs to be here because of the relationship with the market. And then I still remember him in the middle of the 80s tell people a rule, don't be too greedy. And he meant exploitation. Don't try too hard to exploit. You need to exploit, but in a sensible manner. If you try too much, you kill yourself. Which is very similar to looking into the constraint and to say, okay, I want to get something good, like 95% utilization of my constraint. I'm not really going to ask 100% of it. Fellows, one of the things, you know, my base, I came to TUC through software. This is the way I started with Eli Godard, was as a software guy, and then he pushed me into other areas as well, which I am still grateful.
Without the mouse.
Yes. And the thing is this, cost per unit, the sort of nice about it, because it went to the unit level. But why it went to the unit level? Because there is a paradigm say, I cannot make the full calculation on this case. I cannot. So I need a vast simplification like per unit. Or cost per hour. Why cost per hour? Why don't case cost per year? Because when I look on something, I don't have the power to do so. Well, maybe the computers of 30 years ago could not have done it in a real time. But now I look on today's computer and say, for them, it's nothing. If we know how to do the calculation, but there are huge amount of calculation, no problem, the computer can do huge amount of calculations. We are not constrained by the power of today's computers. So why do we speak about even T by constraint unit? Why by constraint unit? Let us go back to delta T minus delta O. And I claim we can simulate the impact of decision relative to all our current sales and all our critical resources, but with all the sales. So we need some support from IT. So it should have something that I call sales profile, which means, what if you don't make any major change, how much you are going to sell next month from every SKU that you sell? Generally speaking, this is, of course it fluctuates, yes, I know, but you sort of know this. And for this amount of sales, what is my capacity backing for it on those critical resources? Because they need to be able to process all those sales, right? This is a need. So I need sales profile and I need capacity profile. I need to make sure that all the critical resources have at least the minimum protective capacity. I will never hit that everybody has exactly on the, I will never hit it.
Hmm? Yeah, 100%.
You cannot hit that everything. First of all, between you and me, we don't really know how much protective capacity you need. You may find out a little bit, you can become better in it, you start with a certain assumption, but you rely on it that some of them will be much lower than that, which is a normal state. Then, fellows, we need to consider the cost of adding capacity, which will take into account the minimum chunk of capacity that can be purchased within the realistic time frame. Well, there are various ways to add capacity. The most simple one, overtime. Then maybe a whole shift. Then maybe calling shifts during Sunday. Then outsource. Then, yes, you can also buy more machines, more people, build new plants. There are quite a lot of possibilities, which the size could be very different in each one of them, but also how fast can you do it? Can you increase capacity? Because now we speak about time. How long does it take you to increase capacity? Fellows, what I'm looking now is to create a platform of decision that are based on the key people in the company coming together and play with what ifs. What if we will do this? How much would delta T will come to us? How much delta OE we will have to invest? Now, let us think about something else. Now let us about something else.
To simulate
each decision and possibly see the ramifications of it on the throughput and on the capacity profiles. I don't want the computers to do the decisions. The computers should make the support, which means part of the whole thing is people gives their intuition. Okay, because if you tell me, let us make some exports to China, I need a little bit of intuition from you. How much sales can we generate, and maybe even what should be the basic investment and things like this. Eventually, there are some ramifications that I can quantify and check. So it involves top management GAZO to make periodical decision using computerized support. So eventually, it will come up with priorities on product mix, pricing. Again, assuming, when I speak about pricing, the big question is, if right now our price is 100, and now there is a decision, one decision is to reduce it to 90, the other decision is to increase it to 120. And for me, every one of it is legitimate. But I need that you will give me some kind of thinking, maybe some kind of consensus. What will happen to the demand? How? So the computer will wait for this, and then it will give us the calculation. If this is a quantity, this is the throughput wheel generation, and this is your capacity profile for making this. That's the whole thing. So it should be able to process what if based on the profile provided for checking and generating the resulting capacity profile for the critical resources. And then if there are deviations, comes the question, what do you do with the deviation? Okay, M3 now is this. Now you need 115% of its capacity, and you already decided that you cannot allow yourself more than 95%, which means you need at least 20% more capacity. What can you bring in? Maybe you cannot, probably you cannot bring me exactly 20% more. Oh, okay. What are the possibilities? And if this is not good enough, then maybe there is another way, and there are some sales that currently are that you say, I can easily give up. Fellow, please see, when someone say, I can easily give up, I need the marketing guy to tell me this will be okay. It will not ruin our market if we stop selling something. Because all the computer can do, it will come up with how throughput will be impacted. But not if it says this product, but because you don't sell this product anymore, you lost clients for other products as well, which could happen. I don't know, but I assume the marketing people do know, so if they give me the data, this will be part of the simulation. And then I can simulate. So So for me, the minimum is the head of sales and the head of operations. They need to look, because sales, everything they say, under this price, under this level of performance, and can sell this amount. And the head of operation needs to look on the profile of the capacity and say, I can do it, performance will be good enough. Because this is not a manufacturing scheduling that I'm saying this is reliable. I need you, the guy, you know your system, you see the calculation, you know what does it mean, can you get it under good enough control? But I think that the beauty of the whole thing is really everyone should take responsibility for his own area and let the computer come up with the ramification. Based on your input, and on your input, this is what comes up. Now we can make this. One more thing that I like to tell you is I find out that the term product has two very different perspectives that caused me to change the name, to come up with a new name. Because one interpretation of what is product is the outcome of operations. This is a product. There is another thing is what the organization is selling is something different. Or could be different. Because they could sell packages. First, when I go to a restaurant, products are whatever appears in the menu, item by item is a product that the kitchen is making. Customers buy actually a package. And now sometimes the restaurant is very well aware and they give price per package instead price per item. Or gives you, which means they have created for me a new T generator based on the existing products, but it is a new one. It is a package for a new price. Or I can sell the same product, but I'm selling in two different markets. Here it appears with my brand name, and here it appears with somebody else's brand name, and they have different prices. And for me, it's the same product, two different T generators. Fellow, can you see? The operation guy is responsible for the products. Marketing and sales are responsible for the T generators. Products deal with capacity and deal with truly variable cost. T-generator deal with prices and sometimes additional truly variable cost, sometimes. Like if it is a special packaging, special label. Okay, so smart could be additional truly variable cost because of marketing decision. But I really want to separate the responsibilities in a meaningful way and still look on the integral impact eventually in order to make a decision. So for me, product, output of production. T generator is what we sell. Now, is this really my capacity limit? Not really. Because normally I can get overtime. Sometimes I have something like that I have temp employees that I'm able to call when I need them. But of course then it costs me extra. Overtime costs me extra. Temp employees cost me extra. Outsourcing costs me extra. But fellow, please understand that when I have this, I can utilize my resources to 100% easily, because my real protective capacity is now my ability, when I need, to bring quickly additional capacity right at an additional cost that I need to consider, because it is a cost. And so I need to consider it. But it does not limit my incoming eventually flow of throughput. It reduces it a little bit, the additional, because of the extra cost. But I can supply any demand, any reasonable demand, okay? Because I have this flexibility. The process that I have come with the support, answers this in full question. Because certainly, first of all, I will use my capacity buffer. It is a buffer because it protects me from the possibility that I will have a peak of demand which I'm not prepared for. And if the demand happens in surprise, because of this, I prepared it. The other thing is, I want everybody to be aware, when I use capacity buffer, there is a certain price, certain OE I need to pay for it, even when I don't use it. Because if I have temp workers that I have not used for a whole year, when I need them, fellow, don't be sure that you have them. Somehow they looked for themselves and they found another solution, which means that you need to give them work from time to time, which means you are paying for the buffer. And then you pay for the use of the buffer. Between you and me, like many other TOC people, I'm a frustrated person. Because here I see something that I believe, from my own judgment, is it could have a huge impact on management and economy all over the world. And its real impact exists, but to so much less degree. So we miss something. And maybe this is part of what we miss, because in the last years, Goldratt succeeded to do it, but he was a genius. To go to CEOs and look them into eye to eye to tell them, I can make your company much more successful than it is now, and really mean it. Most TOC consultants cannot give this amount of promise. They can offer improvement. We can make your production much better. You can produce more with what you have, and you can be much more reliable than you currently are. Please see that not always becoming more reliable in operation brings that much benefit to the company as such, unless all the holistic picture is done and the customers are aware that this company now performs so much better, so let us make more business with this company. And then, can you see the loop? I can be now much better. Now I'm getting more demand. And suddenly, my performance goes down because I came too dangerously close to my limits. Again, I need a tool that at least will give me the warning on time. That can really look from the flow of orders coming in to give you a warning that you need to do something fast. And then again, I lack this capacity buffer to at least cover me for the next 2 or 3 months. If this good scenario, somebody called it the curse of blessing, which means all your prayers are being answered too well, and this brings you down. The fellows is very realistic. It did happen. It did happen to some company. So I think we need to come up with throughput accounting at the right stage. Now, all his life, Goldratt was very much worried that when it's not so simple, people will misuse it. If I give them the opportunity not to define 5 critical resources, it will come to 50. And I agree this could happen, and this will be quite a lot of disaster. But how do we prevent it? Goldratt prevented it because he was such an influential guy that when he told you there is only one constraint, quite a lot of people believed him, there is only one constraint. Goldratt knew, let me tell you this from, I know, that this is not perfectly true. And once he told me, sometimes I tell people something that to my mind will work 90% of the time, and I do show them as if it will work 100% of the time. Because if I will tell them 90%, then they will not buy it or they will do something wrong. I have a little bit different approach. My approach is, first of all, I need to have the responsibility to deliver the logic to the people. Because, fellow, I cannot really prevent some stupid guy to hang himself, right? Using something that I told him. I'm sorry. I've seen also what happened to quite a lot of TOC implementation that done this way. Even with all the restriction, people still found some stupid things to do that were not very good, but they were stupid things. Which means, if the logic will be known, will be understood, this is the only way to stop it. So yes, I accept the challenge. To come up with software is definitely not enough. With this software, you can hang yourself. And I intend to tell people very clearly this. If you don't understand the basic logic, you don't understand what is the role of the computer and what is the role of the human manager, then it will not work. You know that in the second part of the 80s, Eli Goldratt developed a software.
Disaster.
And he called it Disaster. And why is the name Disaster? Because Eli said, if you don't understand the logic of the software, this is what will happen to you. Now, marketing side, I'm not sure that this was such a great idea as a name. But, first of all, the logic is we need to take responsibility that we understand the logic. I don't see any other way. So, right. I say 5, and 5 is an example. And it could be 7. I don't believe in 50. Okay? I also don't believe in 20. What is exactly the number, I don't know. Like Goldratt said, I cannot give you a number. So I will give you a number to start with, but please understand the logic. Understand what you lose if you add too many resources to take part in it. Like the number of mobile phones that are owned by the company, or the number of regular phone lines, or how many gigabytes you can store on your server. All these are examples for things, capacity, that should never be even close to become a constraint. And I think intuitively everyone understands it. Okay? So these are not critical resources, because should not be. Space of an office should not be the constraint. We do appreciate simplicity very, very, very much. From time to time, there is a need to complicate the simplicity until someone and the next genius will come and do a leapfrog and show us again the real inherent simplicity. But meanwhile, we need to keep on with the reality, and when there is a need to move a little bit, okay, the concept I think is still simple. But maybe not one resource, but maybe we need to look on each one of them, and then at every stage, we still should have one clear weakest link in which all the others have more excess capacity than this one. This is, for me, a requirement. Fellow, please see. There are several costs to do something like this. The more higher cost is the efforts that the top management of this organization will need to go through. On the other hand, this is kind of investment of management attention on really the most critical things that they need to do, which is kind of decision about their product mix. And I have this kind of intuition in me. Almost every single organization should consider many more market opportunities that are there, that it can go to them, than they do consider today. It is a belief, fellows. And what I see is too many organizations don't even look on things that they can do that somehow they look to them a little bit outside of what they do now. I try to ask you this question, but of course you probably thought much more about it. But last time I asked this kind of question, the company, very good POC, very good results. Company did viable vision. What they do, they are producing some type of dice for some heavy industry. Really heavy B2B. And what they sell, their top year was 2011. And since then, their sales went down. And I ask why, what happened? So simple, I mean, you know, the economy going down, the less market. I mean, we are still okay. Some of our competitors are out of business because the amount of total demand in the US going down, the US company, they were looking into the possibility of export. Export is for those kind of ultra heavy things, and what they do, more tricky. So competition is tricky here. So they go down. Okay, this is your current situation. What do you do in order that 2016 will be at least as good as 2011? And what I heard was, no way, it will not be. And this, for me, fellow, caused, again, frustration. They are good management. They did very nice. Their share in the market went up. What I believe that they cannot see, that the capabilities they have is much more than doing dice for specific industries. Okay? So come on, look on your market in a different eyes. We are not known in this. Okay. If they would have seen even a theoretical number telling them how much money they could make, then maybe their perspective would say, well, maybe we can. Just, you know, get this attitude. Maybe we can. But you need some kind of attitude to to go there to see that your market is not so narrow as somehow you claim it is.